Hey everybody, Kyle with Dirt Bike Channel. Thanks for tuning in. This is part two of a video series which I'm doing on my new bike setup. This is a process that I've kind of evolved over 10 years and about 40 to 60 bikes, depending on if you count the little bikes or the little bikes and the big bikes or just the big bikes. If you haven't seen part one of this series, go back in the video feed and watch that because it's of vital importance. This is only the second half of what I do, and I will also have a video coming out on protection. So video one was setup part one, video two is setup part two, that's this video, and then the next video in the series will be the protection parts that I put on the bikes. Without further ado, let's get into the video. Hey, just super quick though, if you're watching this video before December 15th of 2020, there are three bikes right here which I will be giving away to you. If you go to my website, dirtbikechannel.com, you can get entered to win the Sherco and the two 2020 KTMs. I don't know what you're waiting for, so head over to my website, dirtbikechannel.com, right now to get entered to win those bikes. Okay, let's get into the video. When you get a new bike, there's enough residue on the brake pads and the brake rotor themselves that your brakes don't really work. Go get yourself some brake cleaner and clean the brakes off. You can also just kind of drag them in by taking them around the block, but I definitely would also always make sure that your brakes are working really, really well before you take it out on that first ride. Get them cleaned up or just drag them. I'll actually take the bike and just drag the brakes around the block for a couple of times and make sure that they're working top notch before I go on that first ride. It's a good idea to check your throttle free play. I think I've got enough on this bike, but over here on the Kawasaki, I don't quite have enough. I'm gonna have to actually adjust that because I don't think there's enough. Over here on the Sherco, this has got a pretty good amount of that. So throttle free play, say that five times fast. On some bikes, you actually have rubber inserts in the handlebar mounts right here. So you take your handlebars off and you can pull the bolt out, and you can actually replace this with like aluminum solid mounts. The benefit to that is then when you dump the bike over, you don't tweak the bars as easily. These rubber mounts actually cut down on the vibration, so that's why they're on there. But some guys want to just replace those with solid mounts to keep the handlebars from being tweaked. Just a personal preference, no right or wrong on that, just something to note. It pays to actually pay attention to how much grease there is on your axle and your hub right here, and maybe even the bearings, because a lot of times there's not a ton of grease back there, and it's easier to take everything apart and things will last a little bit longer if you'll just pull this out when you're doing your wheel and put a little extra grease on things. If you use a little dielectric grease on any of your terminals and connections, that'll help to prevent corrosion. My dielectric grease is all out and I'm getting some in a couple of days, but still a good thing to mention, and I will do on this bike. In order to prevent rust and corrosion, I'll go around and put some silicone in a few places, kind of where I just fill holes in certain places on the bike where just water or things like that could just collect and corrode things. I like to check the position of my rear brake and see how much free play it is. I want that to be just about level with my peg. I don't want it to be higher than the peg and I don't want it to be lower than the peg. So this one is just about right. I also want to see how much free play I have before the brake starts to become engaged. You want that to be around 3 to 5 millimeters. This one might be just a little teeny bit excessive, and I can tune that out back here and get that adjusted. So it's pretty typical on bikes that you can have 2 to 4 places where you can mount your handlebars. On this one, there's actually 4 different ways you can mount your handlebars, because you can move them forward in these additional holes here that I've got them in. And then you can usually turn your mounts around to kind of give you the right position where you want. So a lot of times I will move my bars a little bit forward to give myself a little bit more room with me being 6 feet tall. Some people might want to move the bars back, but be cognizant of the fact that you can adjust the position of your handlebars relative to the top of your forks. When I was on a training ride with Graham Jarvis, he encouraged me to take these steering stop bolts out. That allows you to turn the handlebars further, which really helps when you're doing the slow technical maneuvers. You can take those out on Betas, Sherco's, KTMs, in other applications like the Kawasaki over here. There's nothing to actually take out, so that bike you can't adjust, but on any bike that I can take a steering stop out and make the bike turn a little bit tighter, I will do that. We need to go through and check oil levels on the bike. Now, some might have a sight window like this Kawasaki, whereas a KTM may just have like a seat bolt that you pull out and see if oil leaks out. Here's an example of a seat bolt on a KTM, kind of hidden back in there where it says oil. Pull that out and see if oil comes out of the top of it, then you know you're full. Want to go through and check our coolant levels in our radiator. On a lot of my bikes, if I'm gonna do like some intense stuff, I'll actually replace the coolant with something like engine-ice coolant, because I think that does really, really well. And it's easy to do if you're gonna put a radiator fan on the bike anyway, because you're gonna have to drop the coolant then. I like to check and see if there's enough oil on my air filter. This one, I actually don't know if there is enough oil on that, so I'm gonna pull this filter out and add a little bit more filter oil to that. Hey, before I forget, Kawasaki, why do I need a 10 millimeter and an 8 millimeter wrench just to get to my air filter? That's kind of dumb. It should be toolless. Kind of goes without saying, but we do want to install a bar pad on the bike to protect our face. It should be inside of a helmet, but you still want a bar pad on that thing so that you don't give yourself a concussion or break your nose when you have one of those little nasty get-offs. It's a good idea to check these bushings down here on the linkage to make sure that they are greased, because sometimes they're not. Doesn't matter if it's green, blue, white, red. Sometimes they go a little skimpy on the oil in certain, or the grease in certain places. While it's rare that I get a bike with a spark arrestor, this Akrapovic exhaust actually came with two different screens and I've got one in there, but on a lot of the bikes I'll have to go and get an aftermarket, like an FMF Turbine Core 2 spark arrestor, to make them legal to ride in public land and stuff. Auxiliary power valve adjustments. As long as you're not making huge sweeping changes, you're not gonna hurt anything by adjusting this. There is no one size fits all with this, so I will take the tool with me, and I may adjust it, I may not, and I will go like quarter turns with this. I don't do two turns at a time. I go one quarter turn. If you loosen this, the power valve will come open at a lower RPM. If you tighten it down, the power valve will stay closed longer. It's just about where you want the power to hit and how you want it to hit. Some bikes I adjust, some bikes I don't, but I do minor adjustments on this to kind of tune the power valve. I have videos on that, you can go check that out. Let's talk throttle cams. Inside of your throttle right here on a KTM 2-stroke and even on some of the 4-strokes, you're gonna have a black throttle cam or a gray throttle cam. The gray throttle cam is typically the one that comes installed on the bike, and it's a more mellow cam. The black one is a little bit more of an aggressive cam. With the black on there, you don't have to turn the throttle as far. A lot of times on the 250s, I use the black cam. A lot of times on the 300s, I use the gray cam. But this is a tuning thing for you to go out there and play with. But this can change the characteristic of your bike quite a bit. So, black cam or gray cam. See this thing? This thing was the taillight assembly that I took off the 2020 300 XCW. I will usually take these things off, because what happens is when this is on the bike, this hard plastic, the first time that you have a wheelie over, you snap this and this and you break everything apart. When you take this off, your fender can actually just flex up and pop, and this fender is only like 20 bucks. This is a lot more expensive. And that way I take that off. If I need to replace the fender, it's easy to do. And I can just give this taillight assembly to the next user and saves me some money and some hassle. I rolled the dice and dodged a bullet when I didn't take this off the Sherco, but it's a 4-stroke anyway, so it's not like it has power to wheelie over. The KTMs actually come with a pretty good battery here. It's this lithium ion battery that's pretty good, but because they don't have a backup Kickstarter on them anymore, I want a little bit more assurance. And that's what these anti-gravity restart batteries provide, because it's got a little button here where you can, the battery will actually, is intelligent enough that it'll put itself to sleep before it goes dead. If it ever does go dead, then you hit this button and it resets itself. So this is a little bit of extra insurance. So I've been putting that in my bikes, and I'm just kind of carving out or drilling out a little section here in this bracket so you can get to that button on the top of the battery. These are fantastic batteries. So this one is 100% personal preference, but I like just a little bit more purchase area to go on my brake pedal. And so I like to, in some cases, put an extended brake tip on the bikes, but total personal preference. It's really nice to install a grab strap on the back of your bike here on the seat. This one actually ripped through, but if you can install a strap that kind of goes here, then it makes it a lot easier to lift your bike up out of obstacles and holes and things like that. So grab straps are nice if you can find one. I like these fuel sock filters, these little things right here. You can see how that goes down in the tank, and that would just capture anything, any contaminants that you put down in there. You can get those for KTMs. I'm not sure if you can get them for anything else. I think I actually just searched for Husqvarna on those. It's a little sock filter. I don't know. So it just helps to catch some of that garbage before it gets down into your other filter. It's also not a bad idea to install an inline fuel filter. I don't have one here in the shop right now, but the inline fuel filter would go right here and it would be a replaceable thing. That also could protect your fuel system from getting clogged up and contaminated. Sometimes some crazy things can happen to your electric start switch, like the wires can get severed or you can just break it off. This is a backup electric start button that you can see that I've installed right down here. I think that's a really, really good option when you don't have a kickstart and you want to have a little bit more insurance. Do you have a late model KTM TPI bike that is an XCW? If you do, and you want to be able to bump start the thing on a dead battery, you're going to need to get one of these capacitors. They're not a significant amount of money. I've got videos on this. The XC bikes actually have a capacitor installed from the factory, but the XCWs do not. So I don't need to put it on this bike because it's an XC. It will bump start without the battery. But XCW guys, you're gonna wanna do this, and you can just install it right here. You just thread this up through here and it can just kinda hang right here in your airbox, and that'll make it so you can bump start your XCW. Thanks for watching part two of this video series of how I set up all my new bikes, whether it's Kawasaki, KTM, Husqvarna, Sherco, GasGas, whatever. These are some of the things that I do. In the video number three, we're actually gonna be going through and talking about the protection parts that I put on the bikes, like disc guards and different things, and fork shoes and hand guards and that type of stuff. So stay tuned for that. If you wanna support Dirt Bike Channel, one of the best ways to do that is to use my links for Rocky Mountain ATV, Motorsport, and Amazon. You can find them in the video descriptions. You can also find them over at dirtbikechannel.com. Up in the upper right-hand corner, I have a links button up there, and that'll give you some ideas of some gear that you can get. I would really, really appreciate that. Every once in a while, I also do Dirt Bike Channel sweepstakes where I give bikes away. These two bikes will be bikes that I give away in 2021, but I have three bikes over here, two 2020 KTMs and a 2020 Sherco that I'll be giving away very soon. You can go to my website to get entered if you're in one of those promotional periods. Stay tuned for video three, look at that, three, where we talk about the protection parts. Until next time, leave a single track. Thanks.